Hi, welcome. If you're new here, I'm Camille with 30 Day Singer. Today we're going over jazz style for beginning singers. I have all of the song titles in the video description, so you can take a look at that. I would love for you to follow along with me. The hope is that you can look up the lyrics, you can sing along. I chose very, very well-known songs. So even if the title doesn't get you, hopefully by the time you hear it, you're like, oh yeah, I've heard that song. So the first is Fly Me to the Moon, probably made famous, at least for most people, by Frank Sinatra. A quick note about all of these jazz tunes. I listed the singer that I think has the most popular version, but most of these are what we call jazz standards, songs that have been done many, many times by many different artists. So Fly Me to the Moon, it was written by, let's see, I don't even know. Sometimes that information is kind of hard to find. Okay, if you can find it, let me know. Put it in the comments. We're going to go straight to the song. I think we'll have to do a little bit of noodling around with the key. Excuse my less than optimal voice, getting over being sick, but doing my best. So here we are. Fly. I'm going to see if this is a good key before I tell you what to listen for, and then I'll have you sing with me.
Fly me to the moon. And let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
Okay. I'll go just a little bit lower than this, I think, for my voice today.
Fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
That feels like a more comfy fit for today's voice. So I'm in the key of D minor. The starting pitch is an F. So either you're singing up here with me, fly, or you're down the octave, fly. Okay? All right, and again, look up those lyrics so that you can follow along. A few things I want you to listen for that we'll try together. First, a huge thing to understand with many, many jazz tunes is this concept of swing. And you might know what swing is. If you have an idea, you can put it in the chat. What's your definition of swing? I'll give you mine. So we have straight eighth notes, which would sound like this. We go one, two, three, four, one and two and three and four and. Those one and two and those are my eighth notes. If I'm just counting the big beats, one, two, three, four, I'm counting quarter notes. Swing is when those eighth notes are not an equal duration of time. The first eighth note is a little bit longer. The second eighth note is a little bit shorter. So compare with me. First, I'm going to do straight eighth notes and then I'll do swung eighth notes. So this is straight. One and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. Now I'm going to swing those eighth notes. One and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. So a song like Fly Me to the Moon, we have to have that sense of swing, that one, two, three, four, one and two and three and four and fly me to the moon. We cannot be singing this Fly me to the moon. It's got to swing. So that right off the bat. Another very, very important Frank Sinatra thing is this two-note fall that he does on the word moon. And he does it all over the place. But at the very, very start,
fly me to the moon.
He doesn't just go, fly me to the moon. If you take a look at the sheet music, it's fly me to the moon. But he adds this second note on moon. So let's try that together and then we'll do the first line together. So this is moon. Try it slow. Moon. Now a little bit faster. Moon. Moon. In context, fly me to the moon. And we'll have plenty more opportunity to do this little two-note fall. Let me know how that's going for you in the comments. Ever crazy, you and I are on the same in the same boat today. Behind the curve, like a passing tone. Fly me to the moon. I guess you could call it that. For me, how I interpret that moon business is we're rearticulating the note we just came from. So if we slow it down, fly me to the, stay on that note, moon. Fly me to the moon. Okay, give it a try. I think that's all for this first line. We'll see. Okay, here's your starting note, or here. One, two, a one, two, ready, go.
Fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars.
Okay. Another thing, if you listen to Frank, he doesn't sing among the stars quite like I just did. He kind of throws it away. Let me play among the stars. Kind of conversational. So try that with me. It's okay if it feels a little bit silly. Instead of singing, play among the stars, try throwing those pitches around, like more like you're speaking. Play among the stars. Give it a try in context. Again, beginning, one, two, ready, go.
Fly.
Oh, I need the chords. One, two, ready, go.
Fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars.
Okay, going on, let's see if there's anything to glean here.
Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
There's our little two-note Mars again. And again, it's the same idea.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da on Jupiter, and you stay on that note, Mars, before going down.
So try that. Mars. Now a little bit faster. Mars. In context.
Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
And the second you start doing that, people know it's Frank Sinatra that you're influenced by. If you listen to a lot of Michael Bublé, he does that exact thing too, because he's heavily influenced by Frank. Let's keep going.
In other words, hold my hand. In other words, darling, kiss me.
Not too much to say here. I think the only thing that I would add is vibrato. Typically, you're adding as an effect. You're not using it all over the place. So we're not going, in other words. It's a little bit too much.
In other words.
Maybe just a sprinkle of vibrato at the end.
Hold my hand.
There's a lot of variety as well. If you listen to a lot of jazz, you're going to hear some singers who use minimal vibrato. Chet Baker is a good example of that. And then you'll hear other singers with lots of fluttery vibrato. Sarah Vaughan, Ella Fitzgerald, Billie Holiday, and Frank as well. I would say he uses a decent amount of vibrato, but it's just something to be aware of. When I first started studying jazz in college, this was just, it blew my mind. I came with a musical theater background, and my teacher all the time was saying, restrain that vibrato. You're putting it everywhere. You need to decide where you're going to put that vibrato. So anyways, passing along that advice. Let's keep going.
We're at fill my heart, and you can add that little song. So fill my heart with song.
And then you are all I long for, all I'll worship and adore. Same little two note thing there. Let's give it a try.
Here's fill.
Or fill. A one, two, ready, go.
Fill my heart with song, and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore.
And pausing there, I wasn't prepared to go on. Let's finish it out, though. In other words, please be true. Actually, I think this first time, in other words, please be true. In other words, I love you. Something like that. There's one moment of chromaticism I want to point out. Let's see if we can find it.
In other words, please be true. In other words.
So that little funny note there,
please be true. In other words.
Chromaticism occurs when we're singing a pitch that doesn't belong in the key technically. You can also call chromaticism walking up in half steps. And that's exactly what's happening here.
In other words, please be true. So we're ending on, where is it? A C. And then we go C sharp and then D.
C sharp does not belong in this key technically. So this is an example of chromaticism.
So we go, please be true on the C. In other words.
It doesn't sound out of place because the chord supports it. Let's give it a try, starting from,
in other words, please be true, and then half step, in other words, I love you.
Here we go together. We've just sung,
you are all I long for, all I'll worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you.
Nice. Okay. I think we're good to move on. So that little Frank Sinatra two-note thing, remember that? You'll use it elsewhere. Okay. Next up, Moon River. Made famous, in my opinion, by Audrey Hepburn in Breakfast at Tiffany's. Audrey is not a singer first. She's an actress first, or was an actress first when she was alive. But this version from the song is very sweet, very soft, intimate. So things I want you to notice are this kind of whispery tone, this very spoken phrasing, and then pretty minimal vibrato. Not a ton of vibrato here. You might be used to some other versions of this song. Current or more modern versions include Jacob Collier's, and then Frank Ocean as well has a really popular version of Moon River. So if you're more of a pop person, you might have heard one of those. But this is kind of the classic. Let me take a look in the comments really quick. Okay, and Danica is saying, my vocal coach doesn't like vibrato too. She says people put it everywhere. She's a pop singer, but I like jazz and have a soulful voice. So my opinion on vibrato, because I love vibrato and it's a naturally occurring thing, but it should be either let loose or restricted based on the genre that we're singing. If we're singing musical theater, if we're singing classical music, more vibrato is great. If we're singing jazz and we overwhelm it with vibrato, it just kind of takes us out of the style a little bit. So not that vibrato's bad, we love it. We just want to honor the style that we're singing. So here we are singing Moon River. Let's see if we need to change the key. I'm not sure. Right. We're going to go with this higher key. This is what it is originally, I think. And it kind of goes with this sort of whispery tone. So the first pitch that we're singing is either E4 with me or E3 down an octave.
Moon River.
I think this should be a comfortable key for most people. It's not going to go too high or too low. Let me just play through this entire first verse and we'll see what we can learn from it. So again, here's your starting note. This is not so much an example of swing, a little bit more straight. A one, two, three, ready, and go.
Moon river, wider than a mile. I'm crossing you in style someday.
As well, keep going.
Two drifters off to see the world. There's such a lot of world to see. We're after the same rainbows and huckleberry friend. Moon river and me.
So to me, the key to this song is painting this picture that we're singing about. There's nothing crazy stylistically going on. We're really just singing. It's soft. It's sweet. Not too concerned about restraining vibrato on this, even though, you know, Audrey Hepburn definitely doesn't sing with a ton of vibrato. What I want you to try this time around, though, I'm going to sing it through again. Or I might just, I'll sing softly still. What I want you to focus on, though, is your phrasing. So instead of being straight on the beat,
moon river, wider than a mile,
I want you to take some liberties with it.
Moon river, wider than a mile.
You can speed up at times, you can slow down other times. I've got a question. Lakshita is saying, is it all in head voice or whispering tone? So Lakshita, for me, I'm using a lot of head voice just because my voice is recovering. You don't have to be in head voice the whole time. But I do think that to get that whispery tone, we are going to be relying just a little bit more on head voice. Okay, so this time through, give it another try. I'm still going to be singing really quietly. And what I want you to do is have fun with the phrasing. Speed up at times, slow down at times, focus more on telling the story and painting the picture than, you know, singing it perfectly. So here's our starting note. One, two, three, ready, sing.
Moon river, wider than a mile, I'm crossing you style someday. Oh, dream maker, you heartbreaker, wherever you're going, I'm going your way. To see the world, there's such a lot of world to see. We're after the same waiting round the bend. My huckleberry friend, Moon River, and me.
So pretty. Such a classic. I think one of the best ways for you to practice varying your phrasing is to get a karaoke track on YouTube and to sing with it and not be boxed in by the version that you're used to hearing. It's very, very easy when we hear that karaoke track to just do what the original does. But to be creative, to put your own stamp on the song, get yourself out of that box and focus more on storytelling, less on singing it perfectly. Okay, another classic. I'm going to take a drink of water. We're jumping into What a Wonderful World. And I think I might have to change the key on this one. We're going to see. Nick, positive visualization while singing. Love the different speeds with the phrasing. It is so much easier to vary your phrasing when you're the one with the instrument. That's one thing that I learned. I'm not a piano player, really. I'm a singer. But being able to just play a few chords, it just unlocks that creative potential, playing ukulele as well. And Lakshita said, this song sounds like a lullaby. Absolutely. A lot of lullabies are in what we call 3-4 time, meaning there are 3 beats per measure instead of 4, which would be typical. So 4-4 time, you count 1, 2, 3, 4, just like fly me to the moon. 1, 2, 3, 4. With that song we just did, Moon River, we counted 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3. Moon River, wider than a mile, 2, 3. That's also what a waltz is. You know, if you imagine people waltzing, they're going 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3. And even just kind of mimicking that dance, it's almost like rocking a baby to sleep. So good ear, Lakshita. Nice job noticing that. Okay, What a Wonderful World. You're getting up the lyrics. I see trees. Oop, that's going to be too high for sick Camille, so we're going to drop this baby down. I'll let you know what key we land on. Let's try key of C.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Okay, I think all things considered, that's going to be okay. So we're in the key of C. Your starting pitches are G, B, C.
I see trees of green, red roses too.
And again, I think this is a key that's going to work for a lot of people. Let's take a look at what to listen for. So Louis Armstrong, I know you're familiar with his version, and he uses a lot of his natural kind of grit and rasp in his voice. I will not be using that, but if you want to, you absolutely can. Another thing to notice is he uses quite a strong kind of fluttery vibrato. So I see trees of green. He really lets that vibrato go.
Red roses too, I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself.
Ever crazy? Yes, my voice cracked. It's probably gonna crack again. So just be prepared for that. Not a good voice day for me, but that's okay. Okay, so this fluttery vibrato. I'm going to point out a couple other things when we get to the bridge, the colors of the rainbow, that business. Okay, Here we go. We're going to sing together, starting from the beginning, and then we'll stop at the second time we sing What a Wonderful World, just before the colors of the rainbow so pretty in the sky. Okay? Here's your starting note. I don't know how to count you off. 2, 3. I see trees of green. I'm really trying to think about how to count that off. I'll just go 1, 2, 3, 4. I see trees. So you come in right after beat 4. All right, give it a try. 1, 2, 3, 4. I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Keep going. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. So that little world, kind of similar to what Frank does, huh? Behind the curve, wouldn't you come in on beat 4? You know what? You could. You could. So we could go 1, 2, 3. I see trees. In my head, there's a little bit more syncopation than that. But yeah, you could come on beat 4 for sure. Okay, so now we get to the bridge. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky. We can throw away the word rainbow. Are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I think the overarching theme singing this song is how conversational it is. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky. So the way that you would speak that, the colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, that's how we're going to sing it. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. It's not this very rigid, on the beat kind of phrasing. And Lakshita, this also sounds like a lullaby. It doesn't have that 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3 feeling to it, but it definitely does sound like a lullaby. Okay, let's give this bridge a try. You can throw away words. You're basically just speaking on pitch. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky. Okay, have fun with it. Here we are. We've just sung What a Wonderful World. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky. Are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, and I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I'm gonna look in the comments real quick. Nick is saying this song, surprisingly, still gets him emotional to this day. Some songs are just like that. They just are. And Behind the Curve, God Bless the Child. Good suggestion for another one. Okay, I'm going to move on. I think we're all pretty familiar with that song. The main things to look out for, again, are that fluttery vibrato, the grit or the rasp that Louis uses, if you have access to that and want to use it, and then this just very, very conversational phrasing. Going along with this kind of conversational phrasing theme, going on to Autumn Leaves. Figure out the key first.
The falling drift by the window, the falling leaves of red and gold.
This is an okay key. I think I might put it down just a little bit.
The falling leaves drift by the window, the falling leaves of red and gold.
Is it gonna go much lower than this?
Since you went away, the days grow long.
Yeah, this will be okay. So I'm in the key of A minor. Your starting note is an A, either this one or this one. And let me take a look at my notes. I listened to Nat King Cole's version. Very spoken phrasing. Oh, he does this little trill on the word long that I want to teach you. And I think the overarching thing for Nat King Cole, not only for this song, but for many of his songs, is he just seems to savor the words that he sings. He doesn't go by them. He enjoys them. So, for example, instead of just going, the falling leaves drift by the window, he savors each word.
The falling leaves drift by the window, the falling leaves of red and gold.
No element of that word goes by without him kind of like tasting it and enjoying it. And Lakshita's asking, when I'm switching from chest voice to head voice, I'm just letting that happen naturally. I'm not doing a pop flip on purpose. I'm just letting my voice do what it wants to today. And that's sometimes cracking, so it's okay. But no, not a purposeful flip by any means. It's just, it's doing what it wants. Okay, try this with me on verse one. Enjoy each word that you sing. Those consonants, move through them, but enjoy them instead of just passing by. Here's your starting note. I'll give you a one, two, three, the falling leaves. All right.
One, two, three, the falling leaves drift by the window. The falling leaves of red and gold.
Keep going.
I see your lips, the summer kisses, the sunburned hands I used to hold.
Let's keep going.
Since you went away, the days grow long.
So there's that little trill. Instead of just singing long, he goes long, long. He does it faster, but we're going to do it slow first. I need to figure out what pitch it is. It's C, D, C, long, long. Let's try it in context. Since you went,
since you went away, there it is, the days grow long, and soon I'll hear old winter song.
Another thing that Nat King Cole does, he doesn't stay open on the vowel for a terribly long time. So he could go old winter song and then close to the NG at the very end. Instead, he enjoys the ng of song.
Old winter song.
Another artist, a current artist, who I've noticed do that is Ariana Grande. I did a Vocal Coach Reacts to God as a Woman, and she also kind of closed to the N of woman and let her vibrato ring on that. And Nat King Cole is doing that here. So give that a try. We're doing the days grow long. And then when we get to the word song,
old winter song, you can close to the NG and let that vibrato ring. But I miss you most of all, my darling, when autumn leaves start to fall.
So we'll finish out the song, starting at since you went away.
Here you go. Since you went away, the days grow long, and soon I'll hear old winter song. But I miss you most of all, my darling, when autumn leaves start to fall.
Same thing there,
start to fall.
You can enjoy the ol. And that's a very, very unique thing that Nat King Cole does. I don't hear a lot of other singers doing that. So pretty fun to do. Okay. We have two more songs to fly through. First, Somewhere Beyond the Sea, and then we'll finish up with Someone to Watch Over Me. I would love for you to get questions in because last 15 minutes are yours, 10 to 15 minutes, depending on how many questions we have. And actually, for the sake of time, I might do Beyond the Sea, and then if there aren't a ton of questions, go on to Someone to Watch. But go ahead and get those questions in now. Can be thinking of anything jazz related or just singing in general. And I have to find a key for this song as well. So this is Beyond the Sea, made famous in my mind by Bobby Darrin, but again, a lot of people have sung it. This is another great example of swing. So we're counting one, two, three, four, one, and two, and three, and four, and. I want to teach you, there's this little pulse that he does on the word sands. And then he also does this little pulse on sailing. So I want to point out both of those things, but let's get into it first. Oh boy, gotta find a key. That was not the key for me. How about this one?
Somewhere beyond the sea, somewhere waiting for me, my lover stands.
I think that'll work. Okay, so I'm in the key of A. That's a little bit low. You're going to start on either E2 if you're a bass bass, E3 if you're somewhere around my range, and then if you're a soprano soprano, you could start up an octave.
Somewhere.
I'm not singing up there today. Here you go. Let's give it a try. I'll do that little pulse on sends and watches the ships that go sailing. So those two little pulses. I'll sing them through this first time and then I'll teach them. A one, a two, a one, two, three.
Somewhere beyond the sea, somewhere waiting for me, my lover stands on golden sands and watches the ships that go sailing.
I was so focused on the chords, I don't even know if I did those little pulses. Okay, so instead of just hanging on to sands, we'll go sands.
My lover stands on golden sands.
That's what it sounds like when we go fast, but when we slow it down,
sands, sands.
So you can get it a little bit faster. I do these hand motions to signal to you what's going on pitch-wise, but I think it actually helps to do them.
Sands, sands.
Try it on my.
My lover stands on golden sands.
And then we have kind of a similar thing.
And watches the ships that go sailing.
Same exact idea. This is the note. Go a little bit below and then right back up.
Sailing.
Try it from my lover stands. Here we go.
My lover stands on golden sands and watches the ships that go sailing.
I didn't do the pulse on say yeah. Again, I was too focused on these darn chords. The other things, I would listen to the original of this. Another thing that he does that's interesting and kind of similar to the Nat King Cole thing is when he sings the word fly like birds on high, he closes to the E. So he goes, where is it? Oh,
if I could fly like birds on high.
He doesn't just go high. He goes
high.
And that's uncommon, I would say. Most people would just kind of keep that open. Any questions? No questions? Get them in. Get them in, please. Let me see if there's anything else for you to listen for. Yeah, one more thing.
Da 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 da. Then straight to her arms.
Same exact thing that Frank Sinatra did in whatever the first song was. My brain. Okay, Lakshita, get that question in. Get it in. It's time. It's time for Q&A. I'll start on someone to watch, but I'll stop that song and go straight to Q&A once I see questions trickling in. Okay, Lakshita, I have to send my singing recording to my school in some days for a competition. Can you give me some tips? Lakshita, what kind of recording? What are you singing? I think general tips, when you're sending in a recording. Oh, another question. Is it audio or is it video as well? Okay. So I'll give some tips for anyone who is, doing a recording of any kind. I know most of us do not have a microphone and a, you know, professional studio setup. However, the microphone on your phone is not bad. And the microphone on your phone is of better quality than, say, your laptop microphone or your iPad microphone. So if you have a recording to do, use the phone instead of laptop. The other thing to be aware of is how far you are from the phone. If you are right up on it, that sound is going to distort. So do a couple practice runs, place the phone, you know, a foot away from you, 6 inches away from you. Find the spot that's like the sweet spot where you can be heard, but it's not distorting or peaking. When that happens, I can do it on the mic. If I'm talking too loud, you could hear that starts to distort. Okay, Lakshita's saying not allowed to use any instruments. That's fine. Yeah, a cappella recording, totally fine. Just do a couple test runs where you're placing the phone, you know, different distances from your face so that you get a good sound wave without it peaking or being way, way too quiet. Ever Crazy, I'm going to get to your question in a second. And Behind the Curve says Django Reinhardt's version of this song. Cool. Are you talking about Beyond the Sea or Someone to Watch? Because I would like to listen to that. Okay, Lakshita needs to record a video as well. So Lakshita, I would say this is generally, you don't need to be looking directly into the camera the whole time. If I sing directly to the camera, you know, somewhere, it can be a little bit intimidating. So it's okay if you're looking just off camera, still same eye line as the camera. But if you're looking just to the right and you're like communicating there and emoting, typically that's a better look. That's the advice that casting directors give to actors when they're sending in a self-tape. That's just kind of common knowledge. So that's another idea for you. Imagine that you're singing to someone just a little bit to the right or a little bit to the left of the camera, still, you know, eye line. Another thing, again, I would do some practice runs because sometimes we have weird habits that we're not aware of until we see them on camera. I had a singer friend who like swings her arms back and forth when she's singing and, you know, didn't really realize it until she was recorded. So do a test recording and see if you have any habits like that that might be distracting. I'm not saying you need to stand, you know, stiff as a board while you're singing, but if you have movements that aren't adding to the performance and that are just, you know, fidgeting or playing with your shirt, something like that, it's gonna look like nerves to the person watching the video. So be mindful of those things. Ever Crazy, I'm gonna get to your question. And then Lakshita, I see you have another question. How do vocal warm-ups and vocal stretches improve our singing voice? How does it help us to sing better? That is a great question. So if we just sing songs, we'll probably improve, right? If you sing different songs every day, that's great. That's better than nothing. What vocal warm-ups and vocal exercises do is they create easier conditions for your voice to make specific sounds. So for example, if I'm trying to stretch my head voice, I'm going to do that most easily on something like a ooh, or singing through a straw or humming. I'm not going to do that quite as easily singing a song that just goes really high. Lyrics aren't always set up to be easy to sing, whereas vocal warm-ups are. They're set up to help you learn a certain coordination. So that's really the main reason I would say to do vocal warm-ups is you're training a specific coordination that you want your voice to learn, and you're choosing, or a voice teacher like me is choosing a good vowel for that purpose, a good configuration, a good scale, good range. And songs, I know it seems like songs cover a wide range, but it's not like they're hitting every single note that you can sing. they're jumping around. And then, like I said before, the lyrics can be problematic sometimes. So it's easier for you to learn, let's say, head voice or, you know, stretching into your chesty mixed voice, excuse me, within a warm-up that's designed for that. Okay, Luck, she does some tips for not straining our voice. Yeah, so a better answer to that question is going to be a live lesson that I did on that topic. So instead of me just talking for a couple minutes, let me find that for you. Okay, so Lakshita and others, here is a live lesson like this one. It's called Vocal Strain, Vocal Pain, and Vocal Health. So we talk about why strain occurs and how to not strain your voice. And then as for cracking, I think I have a live lesson on that too. Let's take a look. Sure do. So here is cracking, live lesson on cracking for you. Nick, do you know any apps that can help lower or increase the key of a song? Yes. Yes. Hold on. There's one that everyone uses, but I can't remember the name of it. Let me find it. Okay, here you go. So here's actually a... is it any tune? That's what's in my brain, but I don't know if that's right. Any tune app? Let me see. Yeah, any tune. You can slow down music, choose the perfect pitch, learn to play by ear. Cool. So yeah, you can check that out, but that link that I sent has other suggestions as well. You can also use, let me find the ones that I've used before. If you don't want to download an app, here's a list of websites as well. Yeah, Filmora is a video editor, but they have articles. They have articles as well. So let me see. Yeah, online tone generator. That's one that I've used successfully. Audio speed changer. I think I've used that one before. So anyways, check those out. If you don't want to download an app, there are websites as well that you would upload the MP3 to, and then you can drag the pitch around. Ruwanya, do I need a voice teacher to find my vocal range? No, you do not need a voice teacher to find your vocal range. And thank you, Nick. I appreciate that. Ruwanya, you have me. I'm your voice teacher today, and I actually do have a lesson for you. The short one. Here it is. So this was posted a month ago. It's Find Your Vocal Range in 4 minutes. So here you go. There's that video for you. It's technically 4 minutes and 20 seconds, but there that is. So all you need is a computer, and I walk you through. I think I use Tuner Ninja. I think that's it. So it's just a website. You don't need to download anything. Essentially, what you do is just start at a semi-comfy low note, and then you slide down or you walk down until you get to the lowest note that you can comfortably sing, and then you write that down, and then you do the same thing with high notes. It's not too bad. After that, or actually along with that, let me find an article for you. I wrote this article before I shot that video. You're very welcome. And this article goes through how to do it as well. It also lists out the kind of common voice types. That's soprano, mezzo, alto, tenor, baritone, and bass. So I wrote down the general ranges of those voice types. You don't need to type your voice, and plenty of singers don't fit squarely within one of those types. But if you're like singing in a choir, or if you have another need to know, like, am I more of an alto or more of a soprano, then that can help you out. Lakshita's asking, what is auto-tune? Why does everyone not like auto-tune? So that is a great question. Auto-tune is pitch correction software. So if I sing a note into my microphone, and then I put it into my recording and editing software, and then I process it with auto-tune, which is just extra software within that recording software, I can drag the pitch to any other pitch. So I could sing, but what if I meant to sing, then I could drag that recording of myself, up to the pitch that I wanted it to be. The reason that people don't like auto-tune, or that they think it's like a cop-out, I guess, is because using auto-tune means that the singer didn't sing it perfectly, like pitch perfect. That's not a problem. Like, to me, it's okay if a singer isn't pitch perfect. I think my personal issue with auto-tune, I don't have an issue with people using it because, I mean, literally everybody does. But my issue with it is that people think auto-tune isn't used, and then they compare their voice against a tuned vocal, and it's unrealistic. It's kind of like same thing as comparing your face or your body to a Photoshopped image. It's like, it's not a fair comparison. So that's kind of my thought on auto-tune. Anyways, it's widely used. I don't have a problem with it. I kind of wish it was used less in live performances, because that's another thing people don't know. You can tune live vocals. And I kind of wish that was less of a thing, but that's personal. Behind the curve, I was trying to hit the high note in Leave the Door Open the other day, and I heard myself pushing hard for it. Realized that I sound very similar to a French bulldog having a meltdown. I have not heard that sound, and to be honest, I'd love to. If you feel like you are pushing hard for a high note, one way to counteract that first is to go for that note on something light, like a ooh. So instead of, I'm not sure what high note you're talking about. Is it leave the door open? Nah, it goes higher than that though. So anyways, that would be the first step is, can I sing that note instead of on the word? Can I sing it on a whoo? Then can I open up the vowel a little bit? Can I sing it on a ho? Or maybe even a ha? That way you can start to beef up the sound a little bit. Second chorus. Oh boy. I would need to listen to that. Leave the door open. Oh, lyrics. Let's see. Oh, I think I know what you mean. I think it's definitely head voice though. So I would sing it first in a, you know, woo woo or wee wee kind of thing. And then if you want to build a little bit more power, might sing it on something a little bit bratty, like a na na, ma ma. If it's too high for you, that's okay as well. It's good to know your limits. all right. I have to let you guys go, but I also want to let you know next week, we're meeting on Monday. instead of Wednesday. It's the same time of day, but different day. So if you go on the channel and look at upcoming live streams, you'll see it reflected. It's Monday the 19th, 4:30 p.m. Pacific. Thank you guys for being here. I hope my voice is going to be in a little bit better shape by Monday. We'll see. But thank you for being here and for being patient and understanding. I appreciate it. All right. See ya.